Did you know that the general ledger is the basis for all financial statements? No matter how big the company is or how small, they use the general ledger for their financial statements. In this video, we'll discuss the general ledger and how accountants post general journals to the general ledger step by step. Posting business transactions to the general ledger is the third step in the 9-step accounting cycle. What is the general ledger? The general ledger is the system of ledger accounts that keeps track of all business transactions organized by account number. When you look at a company's general ledger accounts, you can trace back all historical business transactions. The general ledger is also often called the record of final entry because once it is posted there, there is no way to get that transaction back out. You can correct it or reverse it with another transaction, but the original entry is there to stay. The process of posting is automated in most companies, but you need to understand what the system is doing and be able to test that everything functions as it should during system implementations. Typically, the accounting team is responsible for end-to-end system testing when system modifications are being implemented. So it may seem tedious, but this is what you need to know because you will likely be involved in system upgrades and testing. The process of posting a journal entry to the general ledger consists of these 5 steps. On the ledger form, enter the date of the transaction, enter a description of the entry if necessary, enter the general journal page in the posting reference column. Enter the debit amount in the debit column or the credit amount in the credit column. Compute the balance and enter it into the debit balance column if the balance is a debit, or the credit balance column if the balance is a credit. On the general journal, enter the ledger account number in the posting reference column. Now that you know these 5 steps, let's practice this concept with the help of, you probably guessed it, Eli's Consulting Services from our textbook. Let's look at the first transaction for Eli's Consulting, where Trade and Eli deposited $100,000 into the company's business bank account. In the general journal entry, we recorded this business transaction by debiting cash and crediting Trade and Eli's capital for $100,000. The general journal records transactions in chronological order in which the transactions occur, but now we want to have a permanent record of the transaction by account. So our first step is to pull up the account cash and write the date of the transaction into the date column and enter a description if necessary. Our textbook does not list a description, but in practice, the journal entries have descriptions. In the posting reference column, we write the page number on which the general journal was recorded and write the debit of $100,000 into the debit column. Next, we'll calculate the balance of the account. This was the first transaction for Eli's Consulting. Therefore, there is no prior balance for the bank account. And we write the balance of $100,000 into the debit balance column. Our next step is to post the credit for our journal entry to the Trade and Eli Capital account. We follow the same steps, enter the date, enter the description, and the posting reference, and then the credit amount of $100,000 and write the amount of $100,000 into the credit balance column. Our last step is to enter the posting reference on the general journal, which is the account number of the account that the general journal was posted to. Let's look at the second transaction for Eli's Consulting, where Eli's Consulting Services issued check 1001 for $5,000 to purchase a computer and other equipment. In the general journal entry, we recorded this business transaction by debiting equipment and crediting cash for $5,000. Our first step is to pull up the account equipment and write the date of the transaction into the date column and enter a description. In the posting reference column, we'll write the page number on which the general journal was recorded and write the debit of $5,000 into the debit column. Next, we'll calculate the balance of the account. Our next step is to post the credit of our journal entry to the cash account. We follow the same steps. Enter the date, enter the posting reference, and then the credit amount of $5,000 and calculate the balance. Our last step is to enter the posting reference on the general journal, which is the account number of the accounts that the general journal was posted to. We continue with this process until all 12 journal entries have been posted and we can look at Eli's Consulting general ledger. We can quickly see what we recorded in each account, the date and amount, and the balance in the account. Our bank account had 10 transactions and the bank balance is $111,350. The accounts receivable account 111. We can see that we had credit sales of $11,000, but that currently clients owe Eli's Consulting $5,000. The account supply shows a balance of $1,500, and the prepaid rent account number 137 shows $8,000. Accounts typically work with significantly more general ledger accounts, and at times that can be overwhelming, especially when there are hundreds of accounts. However, there is a certain order to how the accounts are organized and numbered. The balance sheet accounts appear first and are followed by the income statement accounts. The typical order is assets, liabilities, owner's equity, revenue, and expense accounts. For merchandising companies, there is also a section for cost of goods sold. This arrangement speeds the preparation of the trial balance and the financial statements, and many companies follow this methodology. In addition, there is a chart of accounts, a listing of all accounts and their account number that you can reference. Now let's practice the concepts of step 1, 2, and 3 of the accounting cycle. Here we have the transaction of March 5th, 2024, where the company performed services for $20,550 in cash. Step 1 is to analyze the business transaction. We ask ourselves what accounts increased or decreased. In this case, the company now has more cash, so that means that the cash count increased. The company also now has more fees income. That means that fees income increased. Okay, the next steps are to decide what account types cash and fees income are and to use the dealer mnemonic to determine the debit or credit. So cash increased and cash is an asset. And the dealer mnemonic tells us that we need to debit cash when it increases. Okay, that's the first part of our transaction, debit cash. For the second part of our transaction, fees income increased, fees income is revenue, and the revenue account is credited when it increases. So we need to credit fees income. There you have it. We need to record a debit cash and credit fees income. We can now journalize the transaction in step 2 of the accounting cycle and enter it into the general journal template. We enter the date, the account title for the first account cash, and a debit of $20,550 in the debit column. We indent the second line slightly and write fees income into the description and credit of $20,550 into the credit column. If the general journal is approved by the manager or supervisor, we can move on to step 3 and post the general journal to the general ledger. Here we have the two impacted general ledger accounts, 101 cash and 401 fees income. We begin with the cash account and enter the date, the posting reference, the debit of $20,550, and the new balance. Then we turn to the fees income account and also enter the date, posting reference, the credit of $20,550, and the new balance. That completes the step 1 to 3 of the accounting cycle for this example. I hope you found this video and the examples helpful. However, the only way to become more comfortable and confident with the process is by practicing.